glad to be here today. You have to love bios. They always show the best side of you. So we're so glad to be here today. I come here to speak to you today on making disciples, but I'm also here on behalf of Pastor Fanu and Passion to Reach Ministries. As you heard in the bio, I have recently joined them as the Director of Content Development and Training. So this is what we do. We've been creating content on how to equip the church in things like leadership and discipleship, mentorship, outreach, and evangelism. We work with churches around the GTA. Unfortunately, Pastor Fanu could not be here today. He's at another church today. But we have two other speakers besides myself that will be here today to speak with you. Pastor Daniel Mills is here. And Stephen Martins will be sharing at the last session, and he'll be joining us around lunchtime. So I'm excited to be here. The energy has been incredible. Pastor Fanu spoke to me last night, and he said what an incredible time it was, that you were open to receive. And so we're incredibly excited to just be able to equip you today, empower you today, to be able to go out and make disciples, to be able to evangelize to people, to be able to bring them in and begin to develop and grow them into mature believers in Christ. We have two other sessions today. Pastor Daniel Mills will be speaking on apostolic transformation, and Stephen Martins will be teaching us on building bridges. So I'm going to be starting off with sharing on making disciples. So this is the commission that Jesus gave to his disciples and the call that he has for us as believers and what it means to make true disciples of Christ and not just converts. As Pastor Daniel will be sharing, he'll be sharing on the apostolic transformation. He'll give us an understanding of, once we know the call of being a true disciple of Christ, how do we truly spread the gospel and transform people's lives? And then Stephen Martins will come in and he'll give us a clear understanding of evangelizing to people with various cultural and religious backgrounds. Because who knows, living in the GTA, we come from cities that are very multicultural. So we need to be able to reach them and relate to them. So today, as I start in making disciples, there's two things that I want you to understand that I really want you to take away. You do have a student handout there. There is fill in the blank, so feel free to follow along as I go. Fill in the words that are missing there. But this is for all of us. Okay, this making disciples is not for the pastors, not just for the ministers, it's not just for the staff of the church, but it's for every single one of us. It doesn't matter your age, it doesn't matter your status in life, it doesn't matter your cultural background. If you are a believer in Christ, you are called to make disciples, to reach people, and not just bring them into the church. We're going to learn about converts versus disciples. But our job, our call, our commission that God gave us was to bring them in and to make disciples. So discipleship goes so much more than filling a seat here in the sanctuary. But making disciples is a holistic approach. It requires evangelism. You know, we need that first conversion. We need converts, because if we didn't, there would be no discipleship. But from there, we need to teach them, we need to empower them, we need to build relationships, and we need to be able to develop them into fully mature believers. So to start off this morning, I love how you guys did an icebreaker. If you know me, I am completely the games person. At our church, at All People's Church, anytime they ever want a game, they call on me to do one. So I love games. But so I had a little one here today. I don't think it's going to be as energetic as the one you just did. But I need 5 volunteers. Just come on up, 5 people. 4 more. Come on. Who's okay, 3 more. Okay, we got 3. 2 more. Come on, we need some ladies to represent. Come up here on stage with me. Come up here on stage. on stage. Two more ladies. One more. Okay, come on up. Come on. So I have a bag here that has five different items. You're going to reach in. Some are really low in the bag. Some are right there. You're going to reach in, and you'll see by the items that I am a mother. Many of them are toys. But you'll see five items. And what you're going to do is the item that you pick out, you're going to explain to everybody what this item has to do that represents discipleship. Why does this item represent discipleship? So let's start over here. Okay. Okay, reach in and grab an item. You can grab the big one if you want, or gummy worm. Oh, tell everybody what it is.
It's sour neon gummy worms. Great value.
I forgot what this is called. A timer.
Okay. So start thinking about what this has to do with discipleship. You got the big one. What is that?
Bridge.
Oh, there's one more.
Lego. Oh, yeah. Omega blocks.
Last one.
Nails.
Nails. So she has nails. Okay, so what could gummy worms possibly do, or worms do with discipleship? Think about worms as opposed to gummy worms.
Well, in terms of discipleship, by looking at the bag itself, so yeah, gummy worms. Sour gummy worms. It's fun. But inside these gummy worms, there's quite a few in here. And it shouldn't be left for yourself. It's good to be shared with others.
Okay, so what could a timer or something that represents time have to do with discipleship?
Discipleship takes time. So it's investing time, it's spending time with other people. So maybe that's.
Good, excellent. Okay, a bridge. What could a bridge have to do with discipleship?
You walk on it. Well, you walk together as disciple and discipler. You walk together, and so sometimes the bridge is rocky, so you gotta stick together, and you gotta have that foundation, that firm foundation as well, and
So, what could blocks or building have to do with discipleship?
Building blocks. For this one, it's different shapes and size, and it's got different colors representing different individuals. And I see the most important thing is a foundation, and then each one builds up each other, and then to accomplish a purpose. Yes.
Thank you. Okay, and last one. What could nails represent that have to do with discipleship?
So, say you're building a birdhouse. So you need nails to put everything together, right? So it's just like discipleship. We have to work together to build that birdhouse. You know what I'm saying?
All right. good. Thank you. Can we all give a round of applause to our volunteers? I love the answers. There were some unique answers that honestly, when I put those objects in the bag, I was not specifically thinking about that. But they were all good. I love the gummy worms, the idea of sharing. Really, worms had to do with representing fishermen and being fishers, men of people. So what is it that attracts the fish to come to the rod? It's the worms. So today, we're going to be learning about opportunities, strategies, tactics, about what we can do to attract people and be fishers of men, which God has called us to be. But I love the idea of the sharing, the goodness. I didn't want to bring real worms, that's why I bought gummy worms. But so the timer, very good. Discipleship takes time. It takes investment. We're going to be talking about that. I'm not going to, you know, make it look good to you or fancy it up. Discipling people takes investment. It takes time. It's going to take time out of your life, sometimes out of family life. But that's the reality of being able to build and invest into people. It's never going to be time that's wasted. The next one was the bridge. So again, good. I love the idea of a firm foundation, walking together, the rocky bridge. But really, we are the bridge for people between them and the Lord sometimes. Sometimes our discipling, not sometimes, all the time, our discipling of people is going to be what connects them to God. And sometimes when we don't disciple them, we're missing that opportunity to bridge them to who God is and what he's done for them. The mega blocks, again, the idea of building. Discipleship is building people up. It's building the church. The idea of the different colors and that we all have a part to play. We all come from different backgrounds, different experience, different locations, but really we're one body of Christ and we work together to build one another up. And nails, again, great analogy of building together, but the nails represent sacrifice. And that discipleship is a sacrifice. But Jesus came and he sacrificed for us. And he showed us the example of living a life as a true disciple. And it's going to take, again, it's that investment, it's that sacrifice, it's that taking those opportunities when sometimes it doesn't feel comfortable or sometimes when it's inconvenient. This is discipleship. This is in pouring in and developing one another. So as I was preparing for the conference, you know, the conference name is Lifesaver. So I was starting to think about that, and the actual definition of lifesaver is someone that saves a person's life. Or someone or something who provides help that is badly needed. Provides help that is badly needed. Now, who in here knows the truth, understands the truth, that's badly needed in this world today? So we are called to be lifesavers because the truth that we know and that we understand gives life to people. It can literally take them from a place just like throwing in an actual lifesaver or just like a lifeguard would jump into the water when people are drowning, when they feel like they can't do it on their own or they don't know how. God has equipped us to be able to save their life. God has showed us the CPR of discipleship. He has given us examples so that we can learn, that we can understand, and then be disciples. You know, we're in a generation right now where abortion kills more babies than ever before in history. Globally, 42 million abortions occur per year. 42 million per year. About 100,000 of those occur in Canada. This is why, those of you who have seen the news recently, This is why we can see such an uproar about a gorilla being shot. Right? This becomes headline news. And you know, in everything that I read about that, I personally did not read anything that said, what a miracle that that child is alive. That the gorilla didn't immediately react and kill the child. Like, to me, that's the story. That's the incredible news. But you see, we live in a society that has devalued human life. We live in a society that it's not important about when life begins. It's about convenience, and it's about what we want. But what is God's standard? What does God call us to? God calls us to be fishers of men. In John 13:35, it says, they will know that you are my disciples by how you love one another. That's what God says. Not by how much, you know, scripture verses you know, not by how much you preach, not by how much you serve at the church, though those things are important and they are part of the building of our spiritual life. But God says they will know that you are my disciples by how you love one another, because God values life. God values people. He loves people. God made us in his image. And Jesus came to save lives. He came because he valued life, he valued people, and he loved them. And before he left, he gave us a commission, a command, to go and make disciples. The center of being a lifesaver for people is to be a disciple, to make disciples. I know many of us come from different backgrounds, different experiences. Some of us have been believers for many, many years. Some of us may be new believers. But I bet you in all of our stories, I'm going to share a bit of my testimony, but in all of our stories, I'm sure at some point there was somebody in your life, a mentor, a pastor, another believer, somebody who attended the church, or somebody who reached out to you, that you are sitting here today because of their investment in you. I grew up in a Christian home. I come from a family, actually, of 7 children. I'm number 5 of 7. So we came from a large family, but we grew up in church. My parents attended church. You know, and at some point through different circumstances, currently today, I am the only sibling who is serving the Lord. And all of my brothers and sisters, at some point in their life, have walked away from the Lord. And I remember at one time when I was in high school, you know, you always think of your siblings as people, especially when you have older brothers and sisters, those are people that you begin to look up to. They're the first people that you really see as your role models. But as they started to fall away from the Lord and stop serving him in high school, you know, I didn't have them to reach out to or ask questions about, you know, how did you do this? I didn't have them there. And so I slowly began to walk away from the Lord myself. I was really good at playing church, where, you know, you could go to a party on Saturday night and Sunday morning you could get up and you could stand on the worship team and sing. Meanwhile, you were hungover from the night before. Really good at playing church, really good at knowing what to say and how to be involved so that it looked like, you know, I was doing okay. But really, you know, I got into a lot of things that I just shouldn't have got into. Parties, relationships, alcohol, drugs. And eventually, I walked into a youth group because I was still connected to church. I still went to church. I still had friends that went to youth groups here and there. And I went to a new youth group. And I remember they did an altar call for people who just either wanted to recommit their life to the Lord or really just felt that they needed to draw closer to God. And I was sitting at the back. I was raising my hands because, again, I knew how to play church. So I could lift my hands, I could sing the songs, I could look like I was worshiping the Lord. And I felt this prompting. And I've been there before where they've done altar calls. I've been to conferences where, you know, you get a rush from the conference. But then you go back and nobody's there to disciple you, or nobody's there to continue walking with you. I came from a very small church, a family church of about 40 people. So the youth group was really non-existent. I didn't have a lot of friends in youth group. Didn't really have a youth leader who was there to mentor us, to walk with us. And so, but I felt this prompting in my spirit. And I went up and I recommitted my life to the Lord right there, because I heard the Lord clear as day say to me, "You're either with me or you're not." As in, don't play church. Okay, be all for me or don't. But that's what God requires of us. Why? Because he loves us. Because he values our life. And so he wants all of us. And so that day, I recommitted my life to the Lord. It wasn't easy. I was still in high school. I was in grade 12. So I was still dealing with the pressures of high school and how to manage that, how to handle that, especially feeling on your own when you don't have a lot of Christian friends. You know, but what I knew is that I didn't want to go back to where I was. So it was that moment that the Lord met me, because I had an understanding of who God was, because I grew up with you know, teachings and Sunday school and my parents speaking to me. So I had an understanding, but it wasn't easy from that point. I actually went on a missions trip in Burundi, Africa for a year after that. And when I came back, I remember just going, "God, I'm so alone. I am so alone." Because, you know, I graduated from high school the year before I left, but all my friends went off to universities. I didn't, because I went on the missions trip. So they were on campus, plus a lot of them were not believers, so they got into the party life again. I didn't have a youth group that I had been a part of, and I remember saying, "God, I am so alone. I'm so alone." And I go, you know, I had some really amazing intimate times with the Lord, but soon enough, God brought a lady alongside me. Her name is Deb Pogensey. And she went to our church, but she had joined actually while I was away on the mission trip. And when I got back, she just felt this need to invest into me. You know, she was married, she had a family of her own, she had a daughter my age. But she would take me out for coffee, she would take me for dinner, we would be a part of all-night prayers actually. That's how I met my husband Earl. She would bring me out to these all-night prayers. She actually was a part of her dance team. She started a dance team at her church, and I joined that. And, you know, it was that investment that she had. You know, I had come to know the Lord. I did. But I was struggling. Because we're not meant to do this on our own. We're not meant, you know, intimate times. We're going to talk about the intimacy with God. You know, that time that we need to spend with the Lord to build our relationship with God. And that is critically important. But at the same time, God has designed us. He has made us to have relationship, to be in relationship, to be in community. And God brought Deb right at the right time in my life where it was going to be, I think, you know, a make it or break it year for me. And she invested into me. She poured into me. She would call me up and say, "How are you doing?" She would give me scripture. She would pray for me daily and pray with me. And it was her investment, it was her time, her sacrifice that she made that I'm standing here before you today. That I'm being able to build and be empowered. You know, I mean, there's tons of experiences we go through, but that was a foundational year for me that really built who I was in Christ, my identity in Christ, because of the time I spent with the Lord and the investment that she had in me. And now I can stand here today and share this with you and be able to say, this is how we make disciples. This is what we're a part of, because I understand the investment that we need to have in one another. So today, obviously, our foundational scripture is Matthew 28, verse 18 to 20. It says, Jesus came and told his disciples, "I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So again, Matthew 28, verse 18 to 20, if you're writing it down, that's the scripture. So what does this mean? What does a true disciple look like? If we're going to be disciples of Christ, we need to have a clear understanding of what a disciple looks like. We need to have a greater conviction of discipleship making. You know, sometimes in churches we've convoluted, you know, what discipleship is. We've left very little time sometimes in our churches for discipleship. We get run down with programs, events, you know, and again, that's a part of community. It's a part of building relationship. But we don't leave time sometimes to actively make disciples for discipleship, for that holistic approach that we're going to be talking about. So what's the difference between a convert versus a disciple? Again, what I want you to understand is a convert is not a bad thing. We need converts. We need to convert people to believers. We need to convert people because without their conversion, there is no discipleship. So converts are not bad, but let me give you a picture. I have a 3-year-old and I have a 9-month-old. And yes, I have a baby on the way. I know. People are kind of like, I'll just put it out there so it's not awkward for anyone. Because, you know, sometimes with such a young baby, people go, oh, is she just still carrying that weight? But anyway, okay, so, you know, my 3-year-old was a baby. And there's nothing wrong with babies. Babies are a miracle. They are a blessing. But if my 3-year-old continues to act like a baby, even at 3, that's where there can be, you know, issues, or that's where, you know, there isn't that development. My 3-year-old can't act like my 9-month-old. You know, there's even times where I've had to go, once we had the baby, Micah kind of got into this, like, tried to revert back to that infant stage. Mommy, lift me up. Mommy, why don't you carry me? Well, because you can walk. The baby can't. So there's always going to be different stages. There's always going to be people need to come into the faith, and they're going to be like babies, where they're going to need to be shown how to walk. They're going to be shown how to eat real food. But the idea is that we want to see them continue to grow and develop. We don't want them to stay there. It's like my 3-year-old. I've had to teach him how to walk. I've had to teach him how to eat real food. I can't just, you know, give him an apple and hope that he chews it okay. The idea is that I invested into him so that he can continue to grow and develop. But is he at the stage I'm at? No. But will he get there? Yes. As long as you continue to invest and teach. So this is where it takes that time. So a convert are believers who live like the world. Disciples are believers who live like Jesus. So believers and Jesus are the two words there. Converts focus on their values, interests, worries, fears, priorities, and lifestyles. Disciples are focused on Jesus. Converts go to church. Disciples are the church. Converts are involved in the mission of Jesus. Disciples are committed to it. Converts hear the word of God. Disciples live it. Converts follow the rules. Disciples follow Jesus. Converts are all about believing. Disciples are all about being. Converts are comfortable. Disciples make, we said it earlier with the nails, sacrifices. Converts talk. Disciples make more disciples. Disciples make more disciples. So converts live in the moment, in that first experience. That's why we need them to to develop and grow beyond that. But God has called us and commissioned us to be like Christ, to constantly be learners and followers of Christ so that we can take on the nature of God and be Christ to those around us. A disciple is someone who finds their identity, purpose, and meaning in Jesus. Jesus is the center of their life. So the actual definition of disciple is a learner. A learner. If we are disciples of Christ, we are learners of Christ to be more like Christ. So the actual Greek word for making disciples is matheteo, and it communicates the idea of a learning believer. We are always growing in faith and understanding of God, who Christ is, so that we can represent him. So let's look at that. You know, if Jesus is the ultimate servant leader, Jesus is the ultimate disciple maker, and he left an example for us. His motivation for discipleship was love. And that should characterize our motivation for discipleship. It needs to be defined by Christ's commands to his disciples, and to make men and women whose lives reflect a deep commitment to and for the Lord, his word, and his people. Teaching alone is not enough to make disciples. I will say this over and over again. Making disciples takes time, investment, and sometimes interruption in our daily lives. But it is the call for every one of us. Jesus' words emphasize not just the moment of salvation, but a lifetime of sacrifice and development that needs to follow once we come to know who the Lord is. John 8, verse 31 says, "If you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples." If you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine. It's the difference between the one-time profession of faith and a lifetime of spiritual growth and increasing godliness. We need to live lives that are holy. God says, "Be holy, for I am holy," righteous life, and that's a continual development. It's a lifetime of spiritual growth. Discipleship cannot be fulfilled by just one thing on their own. Again, it's something that encompasses everything. It encompasses relationship, training, spiritual development. This is all a part of discipleship. It doesn't end once they enter those doors. And I want us to understand that this, we all have a part to play. So, you know, as people who attend the church, our role isn't to just bring people in or be here when they come, but it's about their entire development. Just as much as pastors, just as much as ministers, we as people who attend the church are a part of the body of Christ, need to want to develop people, understand how to develop them, and disciple them. So how did Jesus disciple his disciples? Jesus built intimate relationships with his disciples. His motivation was out of love and to do the will of the Father. John 15:15 says, "I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I call you friends. For everything that I have learned from my Father, I have made known to you." So see, Jesus was a learner himself. He learned from the Father. And then he taught and developed and invested and poured into the disciples what he had learned from the Father. And that's the example that he gives to us. We're going to talk about specific ways that he did that. But that's, we need to learn from him as we pour in to others. So number one, his life was open to his disciples. His life was open to his disciples. Matthew 26:26 says, while they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body. So his life was open to his disciples. You know, as disciple makers, we need to open up who we are to people. It's kind of like, you know, when they read the bio. If people only know me, right now all you really know about me is my testimony and my bio. If you only know that part of me, if that's all that I showed you, or if you only see me up here, same with people, you know, they see the leaders up front, they see the pastor there, or they see you on a Sunday and your kids are dressed nice, and, you know, you walk in together as a family, but they don't see those years that it took for me to develop those trainings, or they don't see the years that it took to get my education and be able to go through social work, and, you know, or they don't see that I have children and what it looks like to parenting, that some days it's really hard and some days I don't understand it. If people don't see that part of you, they can begin to get intimidated by us. They can see us on Sunday when things look put together, and I'm not saying, oh, we need to tell everybody, oh, my life's a mess, don't worry, it's okay. But what they need to understand is that if God does it for them, they will do it for me. You know, a lot of times when I share my testimony, people go, what? Really? Because when they don't know your story, when they don't know who you are, they don't know what God's done for you. And that can encourage and empower people. That can make somebody say, you know, the Lord does it for them, he can do it for me. If that person was where I'm at now and look at them now, then he will take me from this place. So our life needs to be open to people. Jesus served them. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I've set you an example that you should do as I've done for you. That's in John 13, verse 14 to 15. So Jesus served them. We need to serve people. We need to go out of our way. Sometimes, you know, that's just finding out that someone had, you know, a rough day, or they lost their job, or maybe they lost a loved one, and so we make a meal and we take it over for them. Or we call them up and ask them to pray. We need to serve one another. Jesus did what he taught. Jesus did what he taught. So Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of his own accord, but only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, that the Son does likewise. That's John 5, verse 19. You know, we need to be an example to people. We can't say one thing and do another. We need to set the example. We need people to see our lives living for Christ, that holiness, that righteousness that God has called us to. And when we teach people, we need to make sure that we're doing the same. He supported them. In Luke 22, verse 28, says, you are those who stood by me in my troubles. He supported them. When we go through things, we need to be there for one another. When there's days where we feel like, I don't know how I'm going to go on, we need to be able to call up somebody and say, look, can you just pray for me in this moment? He equipped them. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, you gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those that you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine, and all glory comes to me through them. John 16, verse 6 to 10. So he equipped them. God has given us what we need. God has given us his word. He will not send us out and commission us to do something that he has not equipped us for. And so then we need to go and equip others. We need to teach them the word. We need to help give them an understanding, all for their development. And last, he compelled them to go and disciple others. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Matthew 28:19. So as we disciple people, they need to be discipling others. It's almost like a cycle. They come in, we begin to grow and to develop them, and then we spur them on. We propel them to go out and now disciple others. And then they begin, bring people in, they evangelize to people, they begin to develop and grow them, and then they make disciples. This is the idea of multiplying. We don't want to just add people. We want to multiply them. The disciples learn by Jesus' example to reach out to people around them, calling them to obediently follow Jesus. The disciples went about making other disciples, teaching them to obey everything that Jesus had commanded and baptizing them. Some of them even moved to different areas or traveled around the world so that they could evangelize to more people. They took Jesus' word seriously and literally. And on multiple occasions, Jesus challenged the faith development of his disciples. As they followed him, he instructed them. There was much he did on his own, but as time went on, he expected them to take what he had developed in them, to equip them with, and to step out in faith and believe with greater confidence. In John 21, verse 15 to 17, many of you will know the story. After breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," Peter replied, "you know I love you." "Then feed my lambs," Jesus told him. Jesus repeated the question, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" "Yes, Lord," Peter said, "you know I love you." "Then take care of my sheep," Jesus said. A third time he asked him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt that Jesus asked the question a third time. He said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Then feed my sheep." How many of us, I'm sure, all of us here, if I said, "Do you love Jesus?" we would say yes. But does our life represent that with who we are investing in? That God has given us the ability, he has equipped us, and he has said, "Go and make disciples. I'm giving you authority over the people to be able to draw them in, to develop them, because I've taught you. Now go and teach them." And Jesus here is challenging Peter's faith with the challenge of discipleship, of leading people and providing for his people, for God's people. And this is the same call and commission that he gives to us. He says, "Do you love my people? Then take care of them." Do you love me? Then take care of my people. So what is our commission as disciples? A vital key in disciple process is to build true and trusting relationships. I want you to write down the three words here. Relationships that are founded on CAT. C-A-T. Compassion. Action. And trust. Again, in John 13, verse 35, it says, "Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples." The word in that scripture, love, is agape love. Agape love is used to describe God's love, that God is love. Agape love is the kind of love that comes from God. So we are to love his people with the understanding of God's love. This involves faithfulness, commitment, and goodwill. And this requires action. Compassion, we're going to watch a video in about 30 seconds if they are ready for it. And this is by Pastor Craig Groeschel. He pastors a church down in the States, but he's speaking at Elevation Church in this particular sermon. But he talks about compassion without action is not compassion. So are we ready for the video? Okay, so we're going to watch this video, and then I'm going to come back in and talk about it.
Okay,
go ahead.
Screen to screen, than it is face to face. So if you put on Facebook, pray for me, I lost my job, I will comment, oh, I'm so sorry, I'm praying for you. It's the least that I can do. If we're sitting across from each other having coffee, and you tell me, oh, I lost my job, and then you just start breaking down, and you explain to me, I just told my daughter she can't be in dance anymore, and we canceled our vacation, and we're afraid that we might have to move away in order to get another job, and we don't want to leave Elevation Church, and you just break down crying right there, I care to a whole entire different level than if I simply see it from screen to screen. A new command I give to you, that above all else, you love one another. The lost world that is very skeptical of the message of the church today, they will know that you are my disciples by the way you do what? All of our churches, by the way you love one another. What I'm going to argue today is a principle that I hope you'll embrace, that God is calling us to live a very compassionate life to a hurting and broken world. And the argument that I want to make is this, that true compassion demands action. That true compassion demands action. In fact, there's a crazy Greek word that's translated as compassion throughout the New Testament. It's the word splagnizomehi. Everybody try to say it just for fun. One, two, three. Splagnizomehi. I practice that all week long. Splagnizomehi means to have the bowels yearn. It means to feel deep sympathy. It means to be moved to action. It means to be, it's to care so deep within your being that you cannot not act. It's to hurt, to agonize, to empathize. It's from the bowels. In fact, in the New Testament, when Jesus was speaking and Paul was writing, most people believe that love was born in the bowels, that love was born so deep at the deepest part of your being, and that's this word splagnizomehi. It means to ache, to yearn, to long, to feel so much for somebody else that it moves you to action. I would say all day long that true compassion demands action. And I would take it as far to say, that you care and not act is to not care at all. To say that you care and not act is to not care at all. In fact, I want to read you some scripture in the New Testament, and I want you to notice this. When you're studying through your Bible, every time you come across the word compassion in the Gospels, and it's related to Jesus, what I want you to see is every time you see the word compassion, you will see a corresponding action. You will never see compassion in any verse in the Gospel of Jesus without seeing immediate action. Why? Splagnizomehi. It means to be moved to action. To say you care but not act is to not care at all. Some examples from Mark's gospel. Mark chapter 1 verse 40 and 41 says that a man with leprosy came and knelt in front of Jesus, begging him to be healed. He cries out, if you are willing, you can heal me and make me clean, he said. Verse 41, let's all say this aloud. Somebody at Matthew's, help me out. He said what? He said, moved with compassion, moved with splagnizomehi. What did Jesus do? Jesus reached out and touched him. It's easier not to care screen to screen.
Okay, so I love that video because I love even the word that he's talking about, that compassion or love comes from the bowels, is that yearning for people. This is what God, this is what Jesus showed us, and this is what he calls us to in terms, you know, a lot of times we'll see stories with the disciples of how where somebody was trying to approach Jesus or somebody was trying to get to Jesus and the disciples maybe tried to rush Jesus or push them aside. And Jesus, you know, moved with compassion, would act. He would love on them because Jesus yearned for his people. He wanted to see them fully developed. Now, for the sake of time, I'm going to go through some of these points so that you have them. I'm going to leave you with some homework because of time. So what does this mean for us? What is Craig Rochelle talking about here? Number one, the word there is intimacy. We can't be disciples if we don't learn from Jesus, if we don't know who God is, if we're not spending intimate time with him, because we need to love people with God's love, with agape love. And in order to understand that, we need to understand God's love. So we need to spend time with the Lord. We need to be intimate with God. We need to be on our own, in that closet time, investing in our growth in God. Number two is time. So we talked about it earlier. It takes time to develop people. It takes investment, availability. We need to be available to people. And sometimes that means cutting out things in our life or things that we hold on to so that we can be available to people. We can give them that time. Number three is compassion. So we need to have that deep concern for people, the compassion that moves us to action. We need a desire to want to see people living for Christ, like that lifesaver. You know, do we want to see people saved? And the last one, number four, sacrifice. It will interrupt your life. It's a deep commitment and it takes investment. At times, it's going to be inconvenient and it's not going to fit into our plans or schedules. You know, I'm a very organized person. I like details and I like to have a plan. But sometimes when we're invested into people, when we're discipling people, when we're building the body of Christ, it's not always going to fit into our schedules and plans. Sometimes it will interrupt our life because God made that sacrifice for us and we need to make the sacrifice for others. So the going, baptizing, and teaching, I'm not going to go into that completely. This is your homework. You'll see there's some empty lines there. I want you to read our foundational scripture in Matthew. And I want you to begin to research. What does it mean by those three commands? The going, the baptizing, and the teaching. All of us have a role in all of those. Whether you're a pastor or not, we need to go, we need to baptize people, and we need to teach them. What does that mean? How can you play a role in that? Read the scriptures. Ask God what that means. How can I teach people? What do I teach people? And begin to make notes on that sheet of paper. Because that's the actual process of discipleship. The going and making disciples is that, you know, the going is that conversion, the evangelizing of people, bringing them into the church. And the baptizing and teaching is for their development, is to help them to grow, to understand God, who God is and what he did for them. So we're just going to go into, to close off, we're going to go into some practical steps of discipleship. What can we begin to do? When we get this understanding of, okay, God, you have called me to make disciples. You have called me, doesn't matter where I am in life. You know, I'm a young child, I'm a teenager, I'm in high school, I'm in my workplace, whatever it is, you have called me to make disciples. How can I begin to do that? How can I invest into people? How can I be intentional about this? You know, a lifesaver doesn't need to just help people in that moment of drowning. A lifesaver can be someone who teaches people how to swim. A lifesaver can bring awareness to safety precautions. Don't go out past this line if you don't know how to swim. You know, these are areas we want to be able to start to help people, to save people before they get to that place of drowning. And in order to do that, we need to take ownership of being disciple makers. We need to understand that it is our job and that in every situation, at all times, God calls us in season and out of season, when we're ready and when we're not, God calls us to do this. So what can we begin to do when we're in our workplace, in our schools, when we're in our neighborhoods, watching our children play sports? What do we do? Number one, intentional engagement. Intentional engagement. Are you looking for people to engage? Are you looking for people to reach out to? We all have people that we come in contact with on a regular basis. Are you asking God, God, what can I say to this person? Who do you want me to share with today? Number two is relationship building. Build trust with the people that you are discipling. Foster a safe environment for them to get to know you. Once you engage them, bring that trust in, that relationship, that compassion for them. Be available to them and create a friendship with them. Number three is spiritual development. Once we build the relationship, once the trust is there, we need to invest in their growth and walk with God. Scripture readings, Bible studies, understand their gift, and begin to empower them in their gift. Take time to pray for them, attend services and conferences in them. Invest in them like a parent to go from that infant stage to fully mature believers. Number four is model the lifestyle. Don't just teach it, live it out. Let people know even before you have to talk to them. Wow, there's something different about that person. Wow, somebody has, they have something on their life that I want. What is that joy that's within them? Be followers of Christ by living a holy and righteous life. Build your character. Understand the character of God and build your character as a believer. And number five, build community. Continue to build a community with those that you are discipling. You know, if they only know you at the end of it, that's great, and that time, that investment is good, but they need to have other people surrounding them. Invite them out with your friends. Introduce them to people. Get them into a small group, if you have small groups here at the church, things like that. Help them build their community as believers. Discipleship is a process that begins with loving people through Christ's love, representing who Christ is to others, and engaging people with intentionality. This is inside and outside the church. You know, sometimes there's people here at the church that still feel like they're in that infant stage, or maybe haven't progressed as far as they wish they had, and they say, I just want someone to come alongside and help me, someone who has been there and understands. You know, maybe there's somebody in the church that God's placed on your heart that God's saying, go, speak with them, invite them out for coffee. Are we willing to sacrifice all for the sake of the kingdom? What does that mean to you? What are things that you need to overcome and hinder to be able to move out in this? You know, we sang that song, you know, I'm no longer a slave to fear. A lot of times we have fears. That's what holds us back from doing this. What are people going to say? I don't have the right words. You know, we have certain ideas of discipleship. Oh, it's for them, not for me. We need to understand the myths of discipleship and be able to overcome those as believers, because why? God has equipped us to do it. God's not going to commission us without equipping us. He set an example for us. He gave us his word, and he equips us daily to do it. What are some of the myths of discipleship? I don't have enough availability. 1 Timothy 4, verse 2 says, preach the word, be prepared, whether the time is favorable or not. I don't have enough boldness to speak to people. In Ephesians 6, even Paul says, pray for me that I would have the right words and the boldness to explain the good news. Paul, who preached the word all over, he's asking for boldness. I don't feel called to minister. In Luke 4, verse 18, it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim the captives, that captives will be released, that the blind will see, the oppressed will be set free. So God has called out every one of us, whether we're in full-time ministry or not. Right there in Luke 4, it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he has anointed me to bring good news. I don't know enough. Ephesians 1, verse 17, asking God, the glorious Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, to give you spiritual wisdom and insight so that you might grow in your knowledge. Get in the Word, understand the Word, ask God for words of wisdom. God, I don't know what to say to this person. How do I say it? What do I say? I have too many issues of my own. This is something I dealt with huge when I first came back to know the Lord. I knew God had called me to leadership. I knew God had called me to ministry, but I struggled with my past, the guilt of my past, the shame of my past. Was I ready? What had I done? But in Psalm 103, verse 12, it says, He has removed our sins as far from us as the east is from the west. You know, you are ready. You are prepared. You are equipped to make disciples. As we go throughout the day, we're going to continue to build that, to continue to equip. But God has given us the power to disciple others. And in that verse, in Matthew 28, he promises to be with us always. It says, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. And then in verse 20, he says, I will be with you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So as we go forth today, as we continue to build, to be empowered, know that this is for you. It's not for the person beside you. It's not for the, you know, more mature people. It's not for people who are older. It's not for the pastors. It's for you. And that there, I will be with you. Be sure of this. I'm always with you. God is saying that to you. He is with you when you go out, when you come in. And he will be with you as you begin to empower people. But God has called you as believers to disciple people, to invest in people, to begin to move people from that infant stage, that first conversion, and begin to move them into fully mature adults. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. That's what we're going to be equipping you in. And know today that this is your call, that God has commissioned you.